Hi, I'm Pastor Jeremy Hanscom. Welcome to Calvary Church's live stream. Whether you are stopping by for the first time or you are already a member of the Calvary family, we are so glad that you were able to join us today. While our on-site team is setting up for service, we like to share some information with you about the weekly opportunities we have for you to grow and connect within the Calvary community. The first thing you need to know is that we have a weekly email newsletter that gives you up-to-date details and information about everything that goes on each week. The newsletter will tell you when and where to participate in our regular prayer meetings, and you can access weekly content from the youth, children's, and ladies departments, all designed for your spiritual growth and connection. If you are not yet receiving the weekly email newsletter, please go to ottawachurch.ca to subscribe. Another fresh weekly item is our Bible study podcast, available every Wednesday at 10 a.m. on Spotify, iTunes, Spreaker, and many other platforms. Last but not least, foundations classes, taught by my wife and I, run Saturdays on Zoom. These classes are for those looking to increase their spiritual depth and learn more about Calvary's doctrinal principles. Email ottawachurchoffice@gmail.com to register. I'm sure that was a lot of information to remember. For an easy way to connect to all that Calvary Church offers in one place, you can download our brand new church app on ottawachurch.ca. Now our service is about to begin. Enjoy our countdown trivia. Enjoy the service, and we hope to see you again next week.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Let us stand as we open our service with this song.
I just came to glorify your name. Well, I just came to glorify your name. You've got the sweetest name I know. I'll tell it wherever I go. Don't ever leave. Yes, he found me when I was so blue. He found me when no one could help me. When no one knew just what to do. So let me walk with you, Jesus. Don't ever leave me alone. Without
your holy presence. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and
power of your name,
Worship him today. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Let's remain standing as we sing this last song here. Great are you, Lord.
You give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord, it's your breath. Our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
You give life.
You give life. Our love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord, and all the earth will shout a praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, shout your praise. our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you, oh, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out
give him praise this morning for his greatness. Amen. Hallelujah. He's brought us a mighty long way. Hallelujah, Jesus. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. We magnify you. We worship you today. You are worthy of all our praise. You are worthy of all our adoration. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Satayasia no yashu. We magnify you, Lord. We magnify you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. We're going to go into a time of prayer this morning. And in just a moment, I'm going to ask Sister Diane to come and lead us in prayer. But I want us, there's so many needs. There's needs in our personal lives. There's needs in our family life. There's needs maybe with somebody in our family. There's needs outside. It's just a lot of needs. Amen. But we serve a God who is bigger than the situation. Who is bigger than the need. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Shataya Sando. So whatever your need is today, take it to the Lord and understand that the one you're taking it to has no beginning and has no ending. And he's the same yesterday, he's the same today, and he's going to be the same tomorrow. He does not change. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen. Of course, we want to continue to pray for the world stage. So much is changing. We want to pray for those in Afghanistan and what's happening there. We want to pray for those in Haiti and those of you that have family there know that we are praying for the needs there and in many other areas around the world. This last couple days, we've seen our own government, the Ontario government, state that we'll be going into vaccine passports. There will be an effect on the church on how that plays out. I don't know exactly how that's all going to shake down. But we are in unprecedented times. Unprecedented times, but God is in control. Amen? Amen. So if you have a need today, I would encourage you to reach out to God. I'm going to ask Sister Diane to come at this time and to pray.
On Tuesday morning, it was such an amazing time of prayer here. And God spoke to us in our tongues and interpretation. And really, he said he was pleased. He was pleased, not because of the people that were here, but it's just that we come to him humbly. We come to him expecting, like our papa. You go to your father, you expect that he will give you what you need. And this morning, that's the attitude. We already, you know, invited the presence of the Lord here this morning with our worship. So if he was pleased with us on Tuesday, this morning, he's doing cartwheels. because his presence is so, so strong and beautiful. And he's telling you and you and you, he is in control. He, you know, Jesus, when he came here, he wasn't political. He, politics will come and go, but Jesus, no one is like my Jesus. No one is like your Jesus. So this morning, in whatever need that you have, and there are many for yourself, but for others, your family and people, there's never, a lack of need. But God knows every one of them. So imagine that need. And this is something that I do, because sometimes we see the need and we don't claim it. We don't claim the victory. But what I often say is, see the need, pull it down. Take it in, because it's yours as an inheritance, as a promise to our God. So stay in the moment of worship and praise for our mighty God, because he's here to meet your need and your family's need. So see it, take it, and thank him. Thank him for the victory. Just don't imagine. Thank him. Accept it. Heavenly Father, we come here this morning, O Lord. You are so in control, and that's why we have the peace that surpasses understanding with all the turmoil that's in the air, O God, because it's in the air. You are here in us. You are here walking with us. So every need, every sickness, every hurt, every pain, every concern, we put to you, and let the peace of God fall upon your people, so that yes, we do not have our heads buried in the sand. We know what's going on, but we know someone even greater, O Lord God, and in that we put our trust. So Lord, send your angels in masses, O Lord God. Send them flying through the skies, O God, with your prayers answered, with our prayers answered, with every prayer answered, according to your will, because sometimes we don't know what we ask for, but you do. So Lord, we put ourselves in your hands and know that there we are safe and secure in the arms of our Papa. And I thank you for every answer. I thank you for every faith that is here, that has pulled down, oh God, that prayer request. And I give you all the praise, and I give you all the honor. Let's give God a hand clap of victory, Amen, amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Ha. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. I am so excited to see what God is doing. You may be seated this morning if you would like. We want to welcome all of you to Calvary Church. It's so great to have you here. And we're aiming for a September 12th move into our new facility for our first service. It's close. Lord willing, we'll get there. We had some news this week that we may have to bump it by 1 week. We're hoping and praying we don't, but we have some inspections coming this week that will determine if we can get in on the 12th or if we have to wait another week. So pray about it. It's all in God's hand and in his timing, and so we're believing that God has something unique and special for us. Amen. We're going to dismiss the youth class at this time. If you are part of our young teenagers and our youth, you're free to go. God bless you. We had a great group out on Friday night. Parents, if you can bring your children Friday night to youth service, they will be blessed to be here. We had a good group here. We did a small group lesson on this past Friday. And the funny thing I find about small group lessons is people always shock me. And they say stuff and they speak. And sometimes I look at them, and especially with the youth, I think, oh, that individual's very young, but that's a very profound thought they just had. And it is I'm pleasantly surprised. And we had a great time Friday night with our young people. Amen. We're going to turn in our Bibles to Matthew chapter 13. We're going to read verses 24 through 30. I'm going to read this in the King James Version just to throw everybody off this morning. Matthew 13, 24 through 30. Amen, amen, amen. The scripture says, "Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, The kingdom of heaven is like unto a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, Sir, didst not thou sow good seed in the field? From whence then hath it tares?" In other words, didn't we sow good seed? Why do we have weeds? And he said unto them, "An enemy hath done this." And the servants said unto him, "Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up?" But he said, "Nay, lest while you gather up the tares, you root up also the wheat with them. Let them both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, Gather ye together first the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn." There are some very strong principles for living in this particular parable of Scripture that we're going to look at today. And while I have at times in the past made allusions to this parable, I don't think I have ever specifically preached from this biblical text. When Jesus starts to explain things in his parables, he will resort to what biblical scholars have come to call the like/as principle. The like/as principle. For instance, "This generation is like children sitting in the marketplace," Matthew 11, 16. "The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed about to be planted," Matthew 13 and 31. And if any of you are wanting to follow along with these scriptures and these points, there are sermon notes today in our church app, and you can follow along. These are all listed there. "The kingdom of heaven is like unto leavened bread," Matthew 13, 33, Luke 13 and 21. "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hid in a field," Matthew 13, 44. "The kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls," Matthew 13 and 45. "The kingdom of heaven is like a net," Matthew 13 and 47. Man, God really let us see what the kingdom of heaven is like. "The kingdom of heaven is like a man who has been instructed and then brings out treasure both old and new," Matthew 13 and 52. "The kingdom of heaven is like a man who is going out to hire men to work in the vineyard," Matthew 20 and 1. "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who invited wedding guests to his son's wedding," Matthew 22 and 2. "The wise man is like one who dug deep but put his foundation on the rock," Luke 6, 48. "The foolish hearer who only hears and does not do is like a man who builds his house on the sand, and the storm will blow it away," Luke 6 and 49. "The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed that grew into a large tree with various types of birds lodging in the branches," Luke 13, 19. "Hypocrites are like painted graves that are beautiful on the outside but full of bones on the inside," Matthew 23 and 27. In the Old Testament, there was some very powerful illustrations of who God is when you look into this principle. "The glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire," Exodus 24 and 17. "God is like a mighty man that shouts," Psalms 78 and 65. This is giving us the character of who God is. "God is like a shepherd," Isaiah 40 and 11. "God is like a mighty man, a man of war," Isaiah 42, 13. "The Lord will come in chariots like a whirlwind," Isaiah 66 and 15. "God's word is like," am I driving this home enough? "God's word is like fire and hammer," Jeremiah 23 and 29. And finally, God is like a bear and a lion," Hosea 13 and 8. These are just a few of the examples of this biblical theological principle. This parable is a good illustration of Jesus saying what the kingdom of heaven is going to be like. So when we read these parables where God shows us that the kingdom of heaven is like this, or God is like this, or the church will be these things. When we see these things, we must know and understand that these parables are not just something God dreamt up. But we can expect that the principles of the parables will come into play in our lives. We would expect to see these things transpire in our situations. One of the most important kingdom principles that you will ever understand are the laws of the harvest. And so much over the last several years, we have taught, we have preached, we have promoted these laws of the harvest. And we have testimony here today of people that sowed seed and God, they planted a seed and God blessed the seed that they planted. We have gone through two financial campaigns. That's the word I'm looking for. And in our campaigns, people pledged, more money than, I'll speak for myself, more money than I thought I was going to commit. And I wondered, how is this going to happen? And I've talked to so many people that had a similar testimony. How am I going to do this? But then as time went on, gave a little bit. And all of a sudden, as we sowed the seed of blessing, God blessed us as individuals and blessed us corporately as a church. And we watch these laws of the harvest in play. That is, you will get what you plant. At the end of the day, boil it down, this is the law of the harvest. You will get what you plant. If you plant okra, you will not have a harvest of vine-ripe tomatoes. If you plant something, you expect that whatever you planted to grow, not something else. And if you want to change what you are reaping, then you need to change what you are planting. If you don't like what's coming up in your life right now, if you don't like what you're walking through in life right now, you need to stop, pause, and change what you're planting. There is not a person in this room today who is not a farmer. Yeah, farmers. We're all farmers. When I was a kid, I used to have to work in the summer with my cousins on the farm. Oh. When the alarm went off and we had to get up and it was still dark out, I said, I'm glad I don't live on a farm. I would watch my cousins. I liked it when I was really little because I didn't have to get up with them and I would hear them. They would get up, they'd go out to the barn, they'd do their chores in the pitch black of the morning. They would come back, change, shower, get ready for school, then go catch the bus. And when the bus came home, they would come back, change, go back out to the barn to do their evening chores. And so I would watch them and I would say, oh Lord, I hope I'm never a farmer. But the reality is, we're all farmers. We're spiritual farmers. Yet far too often we have a tendency to blame our difficulties and problems on the enemy when the reality is that we are responsible for a lot of the calamities of our life. Financial problems are related to undisciplined spending. Rocky marriages are related to husbands and wives not honoring each other. Poor relationships are directly related to unbridled tongues. Yet we continue to keep planting the bad seeds, expecting a good harvest. That kind of thing just won't take place. It won't happen. A concert pianist gains an audience because of the disciplined practice that he has set them, that has set them a cut above. A concert violinist can play to a sold-out coliseum where tickets for seats are sold in the thousands of dollars range. Why? Because they took time to sow and to be disciplined, to put into themselves and to put into their practice that brought forth something amazing in their life. If you're going to be a good preacher, you're going to have to study. Some preachers believe that if they can get anointed enough, they can just get up and preach. I love what Brother Odell used to say in Bible school. He said, The reality is God doesn't study and you don't anoint. We have to do our part of the equation, not God's part. You know, I'm going to pray. I'm just going to be anointed God and I'm going to get up there and you're going to put the words in my mind. That's not how it works. You have to prepare yourself. And when you have prepared yourself, God will bless what you have prepared. There has to be a discipline of time that is spent with this particular gift. Don't worry about someone taking your gift, because until they do what you have done, there is no way they're going to get where you are. You got to understand, we're not in competition with each other's gifts. And you could have the same gift as me. I find this interesting when we have evangelists come through that are often used in the same gifting ministry-wise. And we could say, well, you know, we could have this brother or this brother. It doesn't really matter. But when they come, there is a difference. Although they are used in the same ministry, their ministry is very different because it is unique to them. It is unique to the time that they put in, to the leading of God's Spirit and how they bring ministry forth. Here is the way that God works. When you ask for something, sometimes his answer doesn't even faintly resemble what you asked for. You may ask him for an oak tree, but be prepared to get an acorn. Because the oak tree is confined to the seed until it is planted. Until it is planted, it will never become a tree. And it's the same in our lives. We have seed that we could plant that would produce something great, but instead we often don't pray for the thing to plant. We pray for the fullness of the harvest. I only got $5. God, you know that. But if you give me $1 million, I'll give it. But I need this $5 because I got to buy lunch after. When God's saying no, where is your trust in me? And we sow the seed. I give my $5. And I trust God that God is going to do what he said he's going to do. And we have a church full of individuals here that could come up and testify today of sowing into the kingdom and God producing something amazing and great that grew up out of their obedience to sow the seed. Some desire to be prayer warriors but don't want the circumstances that will put them into prayer. Some desire to be greatly used of God but don't want the trouble and the conflict that it takes to get there. Some desire to know much about Scripture, but they don't want to entertain the hard questions that come with learning the Scripture. I will be honest with you, there's times I get to passages of Scripture that I just pause. And I pray, God, what are you saying here? God, what is this you're trying to reveal to me? And there are times that I will go by Scripture and read on and read on, but then come back to that one passage, and I will pray about it for days. I will study it for days, praying, God, give me revelation. But it takes investment. No one can bypass the laws of the harvest. This goes beyond spiritual implications. Malcolm Gladwell says that 10,000 hours of intense practice is what it takes to achieve mastery of a complex skill. Now, some would disagree with him with that, but basically his point is if you go out and you practice something for 10,000 hours, you are going to become a mastery in that field, that area. So somewhere, this has been built into us. Not just spiritually, but physically as well. In where you are in your life, and where you are in your job, and the talents and the abilities that you can do, you learned them somewhere and you picked them up, and maybe you had to go to school and be taught and reach some level of education before somebody could say, hey, you've achieved this level. You can now be this person, or you now are licensed to do this. And we understand that. And the same thing goes not just in the physical, but in the spiritual realm as well. Zechariah 4:10 says, "For who hath despised the day of small things? For they shall rejoice and shall see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel with those seven. They are the eyes of the Lord which run to and fro through the whole earth. Don't be frustrated with the small beginnings of the seed. Don't be frustrated by that. Don't be frustrated with the pediatrics of prayer. Don't be frustrated by the small amount of faith that you have. Don't be frustrated by the small amount of wisdom and revelation that you have. Stay disciplined to the principles of God and study the Word and pray and learn from the Spirit leading you. And my friend, time will go by and you will look back and say, man, look how far I've come. Look at what God has done in my life. Don't be frustrated by small amounts. We all started there. You know, I got this Bible. I was mentioning to Brother Dan the other day. He stopped in the office, and I was sitting there, and we were talking about my books and hopefully moving them upstairs. And I said to Brother Dan, I said, look at all the Bibles I have here on this shelf. And a lot of times people give me Bibles as gifts in the past, and I'll put them on my shelf. I got all these Bibles. And as I was looking, there was one Bible there. I almost took it out to show Brother Dan, but the conversation shifted and I didn't. But I got this black case, this tiny little King James Version Bible in this case. That was mine when I was a kid. And I like to open it up from time to time, because in there I have things highlighted. And I'd write little notes beside it, things that I found interesting in Scripture. And I can go back and look at those things now and say, man, I really didn't know what I was doing back then. I wasn't really sure what the Scripture was saying. But I can see some of my journey of where I started as a child and how I've progressed. I have another Bible that I used when I was in college, in Bible college. And inside it, there's all kinds of notes written out and, you know, on a subject matter. For instance, the oneness of God, and there will be a starting scripture. And if I go to turn to that scripture, there's another scripture that would lead to another scripture. And so I built these sort of Bible studies throughout the Bible on certain topics. And I look at that now, and some of those scriptures, you know, they've changed in meaning to me somewhat. I have a different understanding of them, but that is the process of growth. And so I would say to you today, if you're new to your walk with God, just relax. It's not a race. It's not a race. Just relax, trust God, grow in God. It's great to have people we can point to and we can look at and say, oh, I love the prayer life of so-and-so, or I would love to have the knowledge of Scripture as so-and-so, or I would love to have, this gifting or that gifting like so-and-so. It's okay to look at people and say, hey, I would like to, you know, be like that person in ministry, but you don't try to be that person. Let God grow in you what is unique to you. Let God bring up, he needs you to be unique in the kingdom of God. He needs you to be unique and bring the giftings and the abilities and the characteristics that you have to the table. Because I can't do it. I don't have those giftings. Somebody else can't do it. They don't have those giftings. This is what God has given to you. But don't be discouraged if you're new to growing in walking with God. God will lead you. God will open your mind. God will show you revelation. God will teach you the things of Scripture as you continue to walk with Him. Our second point today is the principles of the harvester. The first one is there will be tares in the harvest. Matthew 13:25 of our text says, but while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. When the blade sprung up and brought forth fruit, there appeared tares. In getting their harvest, the best of what the seed had to offer, the bad appeared there at the same time. There are times in life when you gain the harvest, but amidst that great harvest, the dilemma of the unexpected sits in. It was something that you did not anticipate coming with the harvest. You have gained the harvest, but you also have to contend with the conflict that comes with the wheat. There are night seasons that every saint of God and every church will have to endure. The tares were planted by the enemy. Don't think for a moment that the enemy is going to roll over and just let the harvest take place in your life. Don't think that the enemy is just going to give you particularly a pass on receiving the harvest, receiving the blessings of God in your life. No, it is the enemy's job to try to slow down the blessings of God in your life, to try to hinder the Spirit of God moving in your life. It is the enemy's desire to trip you up and pull you out of the goodness and the mercies of God. And I will say, as goes the individual in a church, so does the church. And we cannot expect that it would happen to us individually, but not happen to us corporately. The enemy is working at all hours and all the time to bring a negative thing into our lives, to bring a negative thing into the church body. He tries to sneak things in that would try to distract us or pull us off the direction God would have us go. There can be an anxiety about the harvest when you begin to think about the mixed conditions of the crops. Not everything growing in our lives are the result of God's blessings. Now, this sometimes is hard for us to understand. There could be doors that open up that the enemy uses to choke out the true blessings of God. One of our young people actually mentioned this on Friday night, and we were talking, and they were talking about their desire to make sure that they're going in the right direction, that God would, you know, in their schooling and their choice of direction for their life and their career and all these things. And I remember being that age and having the same anxieties and the same worries. God, where do you want me to go? God, what do you want me to do? And I remember as a young man having a lot of anxiety about missing the leading of the Spirit. I worried about that. And I would say, well, what happens if God tries to show me something and I'm just too consumed with other things to see it, and I'll miss it? But I've come to learn that as long as you have a heart that is hungry for God, and as long as you have a heart and a spirit that's pliable to the Spirit of God, if you miss it the first time, God will bring it back to you a second time. And if you miss it a second time, the mercies and the grace of God are good enough to bring it around again. And as long as we are still open to hearing from God, and as long as we are still open to following God, God will work with us. Because God remembers we are but dust. Well, we think we're complicated. Ooh, look at all that we can do and can't do. You know, I say to my dogs all the time, they look at me, and I got two big dogs, and they're very strong, powerful dogs, and they could take me out probably pretty quick if they wanted to. But when I say, hey, you guys want some cookies? Oh, man, they line up at the cookie door. They sit down, and they wait patiently. And I'll get those cookies out, and I'll look at them, and I'll say, you see these? This thumb right here? This makes me your master. Because I can do things with my hand that you can't do with your paw. Like get cookies out of the cupboard. And so we can look at things and we can see these things and we can know, hey, you know what? God is at work. And when it comes to you and I, God has made us specific for the task at hand. Specific for the task at hand. God is desiring to work with us. And I remember as a young man, and this young lady made mention of this, and it just really has been spinning in my head, because I've had to get to a place in my relationship with God where I've had to take that anxiety off myself and just trust God, that God, if I don't hear you the first time, hit me on the back of the head and bring it around the second time. Because you got to know, God, my desire is to follow you. My desire is to hear your leading. My desire is to know your direction for me. I apologize, but man, I'm just dirt. I'm just made out of the dust. And we think we are something else because we are humans and we can do all this stuff. But God remembers, I formed you out of the dirt and I breathed the breath of life into you. I know exactly who you are. So go easy on yourself. Not everything that grows in our lives are the result of God's blessing. And so there could be doors that open up that the enemy uses to choke out the true blessings of God. And so, you know, we may want something. We may pray for something, you know, a new job, that position that has opened up, more pay, all the benefits are greater. And we pray, God, that's my job. God, bless me with that. God's going to do. But we don't know what that job could do to us. It may take us more time in our week that would take us out of relationship with God. It may eat into our Bible time. It may eat into our prayer time. It may eat into our family time. It may eat into my church attendance time. It may eat into all these things. And so the physical blessing, yes, but it's a spiritual shot to our spiritual walk with God. And so we need not just to look at something and say, oh, it's good, it must be a blessing of God, but we need to look at it and say, is this something God put in my life? Or is this something the enemy has put in my life to distract me from what God wants me to do? The enemy will work to assassinate, terrorize, destroy, and cripple the plan that God has for your life. Charles Dickens maybe said it best, it's the best of times and it is the worst of times. It's one of the devil's chief efforts, hindering the work of the harvest. You will never get a full harvest without some calamities taking place. Just when you're about to touch the harvest, expect that the tares will come against you. In other words, when you're expecting and you're walking after God, expect there's going to be some pushback. Be careful that you recognize what is truly a spiritual battle and what is just a bad choice. There are some times that we have problems because of our own planning. It's an expression of, you know, seed time and harvest. If you plant it, it's going to grow. What you have to embrace is the need for discipline and priorities. Discipline and priorities. This is one of the things that sometimes entrap Pentecostals. We have a tendency to give the devil too much credit for our bad choices. Be careful that you don't get deep when you need to get disciplined. Be careful you don't just start drilling down on, oh, this, the enemy, man, praying, God, remove the enemy. When God's just saying, no. You just need to get disciplined. Oh, God, the enemy's taking all of my finances. God says, well, you need to stop buying lottery tickets. I close my eyes on that one, and I'll look this way. You need to stop going to the casino. Oh, you need to stop. You need to stop wasting what I'm giving you. I'm blessing you with seed that you can sow into a harvest and see it reap into something great, but you're throwing it in the wrong direction. You know, people may choose to eat unhealthy their whole life, and then they develop sickness, and they come and they say, God, heal me of this sickness. God says, just stop eating pizza. You notice every week I bring it back to pizza, because pizza and I have a really deep relationship. How often are we the problem of our own situations? But we pin it on something else. We ask God to do something for us when God says, no, you just need to be more disciplined. You know, this was me going in high school in the exams. I studied not very well. And I would go in and say, oh, God, hear my cry, oh, Lord. Tend unto my plea. Teach me math, everything I needed to know right now. Bring it back to the memory I never put it in. God says, I can't give you something you didn't put in there. We have to do our part. Whether it's education-wise or whether it's in our job or in our family or whatever it is, we have to do our part. God sometimes allows us to get in trouble so we can see how strong that He is. And all that we have to do is to look at the Old Testament for this kind of idea. God could have gotten the children out of Egypt without any problem, but the Bible tells us that He hardened Pharaoh's heart.
God determined to set Pharaoh's teeth on edge, and he did. Pharaoh got nasty. He got sarcastic and deadly, all because God let him play into his plan. The lesson that God wanted to hold forth was the thought that Israel really had not seen God in action for about 430 years. So he stirs up the hatred of the king of Egypt. He makes life miserable for Israel, and they begin to cry out to the Lord. It put panic in their hearts. It put terror in their minds, and it put fear in their faith. So when God turns into a deliverer and pulls us out of a horrific situation, you can't help but to give yourself to some exuberant worship and praise and magnifying God, because God allowed it and an unexpected enemy to go to work in Egypt, and God brought them out in deliverance. And he desires to do the same for you and me, to bring us out in deliverance. Isaiah 54:17 says, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. And every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. The way that we want it is for the weapon to never be formed. That's what we want. God, just don't let the weapon be formed. But God determines to show us the weapon and then the deliverance. And when the deliverance comes, oh, how sweet is the victory. When we look back and we say, hey, look at the weapon that the enemy had formed against us. But God walked us through that. And although the enemy tried to bring us down and tried to destroy us and tried to wreck us, God had something else in store for us. And he brought us up out of Egypt. If you get scared enough, you'll buckle with fear. You know, I you've probably heard of this, and it's not a new thing, but several years ago, in the war on terror and when the U.S. was involved in what was happening overseas in the Middle East, we started to hear about this technique of interrogation called waterboarding. Waterboarding technique was put under such a scrutiny a few years ago, and some of the captured terrorists were subject to this form of interrogation, and according to one article, most of them gave up all sorts of secrets when they thought they were going to die. This is a grueling process where men are put into conditions that they think they are going to drown. And the toughest of them lasted about 30 seconds before they began to give up secrets. United States Special Forces, some of their guys in training were put under similar conditions. And they were tested. They were waterboarded. And the best of the best Special Forces guys, 30 to 40 seconds, they started to give up secrets. Why? Because of the fear. Because of the fear. I want to tell you today, in the midst of the fear, we need to understand that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. It may seem like we're sinking. It may seem like we're drowning. But we have a God who's still in control. And he is not going to allow the enemy to destroy us. And he is not going to allow the enemy to have victory over us. He is going to come to our aid. He is going to come and do what he promised he would do and deliver us. Somewhere along the way, you will have to decide that God is God and you're going to serve him. Don't halt between two opinions. Choose you this day whom you will serve. Don't ever let the presence of tares get you rattled. God let the enemy in simply to preserve your integrity and my integrity. I remember years ago reading the story of and his name now escapes me. Just came pop back into my head, but he was a world-class sniper in the U.S., and he fought the Vietnam War, and he would go into, I read his autobiography, and he would oftentimes go into situations that were suicide missions, quote-unquote.
that they told him, you probably will not come back from this. But he believed in the plans that he made so much that he would follow through with them. And one of his last missions, they told him, his name was Charlie something. I can't remember. But maybe Brother Bartlett would remember this. But he had a white feather. He was known, and he would put a white feather down, and the Viet Cong would get very nervous when they would see that white feather because they thought this guy's in somewhere in the region. And so they sent him on this one last mission, and they told him, you probably won't come back from this. And so he laid out a plan, and in his plan, he had to crawl across a piece of open field to get in position for his shot. And he said that as he crawled, it took him days and days to get just not very far because he had to move so slowly. And as he was crawling across, oftentimes guards would walk by just a few feet from him. And he was laying out in the sun in Vietnam. And he said there were snakes that would crawl over him, and bugs would crawl up in his clothes and bite him, and he couldn't move, and he said there was times when he would feel like he was losing his mind, his insanity, and he would think to himself, what have I done? I'm never going to get out of here. But he said then he would remember, no, my plan made sense. When I made my decision to do this mission, there was a plan that I made up that made sense. And if I stick with my plan, I can accomplish what I set out to do. My friend, we have to make up some decisions in our mind. Is he God or is he not God? And when we make up the decision that he is God and he is for us, then when the enemy comes against us and we may struggle and we may say, God, what's going on? I'm dying out here. We need to remember, I made a decision. He's still God. It may look like I'm sinking, but I'm not going down. It may look like I'm going to go under, but at the last minute, I know his hand will come through and pick me up again. He is still God. And that is the story of Job. He refused to give in to the voice that we're all calling for him to violate his integrity with God. Tares don't mean failure. They simply are pointing to a harvest that is simultaneously taking place. Two harvests are taking place. And we have to be aware. The second point, don't look for quick fixes. And I'm coming to a close soon, very quickly. Matthew 13, 28 and 29, he said unto them, an enemy hath done this. The servant said unto him, wilt thou then we go gather them up? You want us to go out and just rip up the tares now, master? And the master of the field, the owner of the field, he said, nay, lest while ye gather up the tares, ye root up also the wheat with them. Remember that there will be tares in the harvest. The next principle for harvesters is don't look for quick fixes. One of the things that we can do when we are in a panic mode is make irrational choices that 24 hours later we're going to wish that we would not have made. They discover the presence of the tares and they report it to the man in charge. Our enemy has planted this among us. What are we going to do? Do you want us to rip them up now? Sometimes the best thing to do is just to stand still. Stand still and let God be God. Psalms 46, 10, 11. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Ephesians 6:13 says, wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. It didn't knock me down that time. I'm still standing here. Enemy, you came at me hard that time, and I took some punishment, but I'm still standing here. Our emotions will do their best to control us, but don't give in to the panic to do something quick. Don't do something based solely on your emotions. Quick fixes will be destructive. Scripture gives us several valid examples of this kind of thing. Abraham and Hagar, conflict with Ishmael. Jacob deceiving Isaac, conflict with Esau. Naomi and her family fleeing in a famine. Moses tried to help God in his flesh and murdered a man, and it put him on a 40-year detour to God's plan.
If you do what you're going to do, what you want to do, you're going to destroy the harvest. This is God's business. Let God deal with it. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. My goodness. Sometimes you can do the right thing at the wrong time. You can be right and still be wrong. If you lose your sense of timing, it will come to nothing. Let God's timing take care of it. It is not that God is not going to deal with it, but He will let those tares remain in your life until the timing is right. You may pray for God to deliver you, but He wants to walk you through and teach you how to live with the troubling tares that you think are destroying the harvest. So God will tell you to leave it alone because it doesn't matter. There will be times in your walk with God that you will have to deal with the inconvenience of life so that the harvest can come to pass in its fullest measure. It is for the glory of God. He can bless you in a hostile environment. It doesn't matter what the enemy is doing around about you, because the scripture says He can set out a banquet table in the presence of your enemies. He doesn't care about what's going on around you. He can just put out a table of blessing and say, hey, sit down and eat in the presence of your enemy when they're trying to destroy you. Let them see you eat on the blessings of goodness. Oh, man. What's more aggravating for an enemy than when he's trying to pull you down and he's at work in attacking your life and he looks and he sees you sitting, eating, enjoying, relaxing on the blessings of God. Man. Pharaoh may hate you. The tares may be presented around you. Pharisees wagging their heads and their tongues. Giants trying to kill you. Critics trying to derail you. Stand still and know that He is God. Do not be quick to react. He is God. The season belongs to God. Our third point, Matthew 13:30. Let both grow together until the harvest. And the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. Remember that there will be tares in the harvest, and don't look for quick fixes. Lastly, know that the season belongs to God. The season belongs to God. The tares and the wheat were both dependent on the season. That means that neither of them controlled the season. God was in charge of the season. When the time is right, the tares are going to be gathered, bundled up, and removed. Don't let the tares choke you. Don't let the tares destroy your faith. Don't let the tares push you to bad choices. Don't let the tares annihilate your courage. Don't let the tares cast down your vision. Don't let the tares squeeze the hope out of you. God can set things in such an order that He will put your enemies under your feet. Don't be upset that they aren't under your feet right now. Just give it some time. The season is coming and God will settle it all out. You can know beyond the shadow of a doubt that when you begin to see God working the harvest, He is about to take the tares and haul them off. You can be guaranteed that. I remember Brother Kleindent saying that some of his greatest moments in walking in the realm of the Spirit and experiencing, you know, sort of the highs in God were also some of his lowest points in his life. He said, on Sunday, I would see God move in a magnificent and powerful way. And then he said, on Monday, I would be peeking out from underneath the bed covers because he was just so beaten down. But when God is doing something, He is also removing the tares. What was trying to attack you will be removed. What was trying to hinder you will be removed. What was trying to affect you will be removed. What was trying to discourage you will be removed. Psalms 18:36-38, Thou hast enlarged my steps under me, that my feet did not slip. I have pursued mine enemies and overtaken them. Neither did I turn again till they were consumed. I have wounded them that they were not able to rise. They are fallen under my feet. You have to believe the scripture. You have to believe it. There is coming a time in your life when all of the attacks of the enemy and the attacks of the tares are going to be put under your feet. You will walk in victory if you will stay close to God. Isaiah 54:17, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. Every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment thou shalt contemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. If you are a servant of God, this is your promise. This is your heritage. And the Bible says, and their righteousness is of he, saith the Lord. John 8:44, he was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. This is speaking about the enemy. He is a liar. Whatever he is bringing into your life and he is threatening with you with it, you need to understand it is a lie from the mouth of a liar. We need not listen to him. We need not focus on him. We need not pay him the attention, but we need to pay attention to the God of the harvest. We need to pay attention to the one who's getting ready to reap a harvest in our lives. We planted some things. God allowed it to grow. He's wanting us to possess it. He's wanting us to take it on. The enemy's trying to distract us, but we will not take our eyes off God. Amen. I'm going to ask the musicians to come back, and I'm closing quickly. You need to give God every detail of your life. You need to give God every detail of your fears, your worries, your tribulations, your difficulties, and in time, he will put them under your feet. I ask you today, what is weighing on your heart right now? What is that thing that is trying to sink your ship? What is that thing when you wake up in the morning is the first thing to pop in your mind? That first negative thought, negative idea that pops in your mind in the morning. It tries to pull you down and tries to hold you back throughout your day. What negative things are you witnessing growing in your life? God says, you know what? Don't worry about that. In its season, he will move it from your life. Don't pursue it. Don't chase after it. Just let God handle it. And at harvest time, there will be two options that we can choose to focus on. The tares or the harvest. The tares or the harvest. Because if there is going to be a harvest, the Bible lets us know there's going to be tares. And as we push into the harvest, we need to be aware that there is an enemy that is trying to push back. There is an enemy trying to steal our direction. There is an enemy trying to steal our motivation, trying to steal our focus. I choose as an individual today to not focus on the negativity of the tares, but to focus on the positivity of the harvest. The positivity of the harvest. There will always be trials. There will always be struggles as we go through life. But I am not going to focus on the struggle. I'm going to focus on the blessing. I'm going to focus on the hand that has reached out to me when I was sinking in the water, like Peter did when he was walking on the water and he looked around at all the turmoil around him and his faith was shaken and he started to sink. Jesus reached out and grabbed him and brought him back up. I am going to focus on the hand that is reaching out to grab me and bring me back up. I refuse to focus on all the turmoil that is surrounding me. I refuse to focus on all the negativity that the enemy tries to push into my life. Man, you turn on the news, you read the paper, life is just full of negativity. Even a positive story ends up with a negative connotation. It's amazing to me. Look at this cute little dog. He wandered away from his family, and then he traveled 2,000 kilometers to find them again. And this is a great story, and the children are excited. And then there's always some negative twist. But he lost his right ear on the way home. I think negativity sells CNN and all those organizations.
But we can choose to focus on the negativity, or we can choose to focus on the blessing. And in all the turmoil in our world today, I'm telling you, we are a blessed, blessed, blessed people. The fact that we were able to get up today, stand on our two feet, get dressed, get in our vehicle, eat a healthy breakfast, drive to church, sit in this beautiful building, and we could say, look around here and say, oh, Pastor, everything, you know, things are dusty and cluttered, and this isn't. Hey, we're still blessed to be here today. God has blessed us with this building and with a new building. And there are people that today have no place to meet. They're renting facilities. They're renting space. And we walk in into the blessings of the Almighty God. We are blessed today. Stand with me this morning. I think the tares in our lives are all different to us. The enemy knows our weaknesses. He knows where we are more fearful. You know, between my wife and I, there's things that she struggles to trust God for, and I don't have any problem with that. I look at that situation, I say, oh, God's going to take care of it. How do you know? Because he's just going to. I just know. But then there's things in my life that I struggle with. Like, oh, what's, God, what are you doing here? God, what's going on? My wife says, don't worry about it. God's going to take care of it. It's all in him. It's all in his control. And so we're all different. And some of us may have a fear of finance. Some of us may have a fear of job security. Some of us may have a fear of relationship security. Whatever it might be in our life, our fears are sometimes unique to us. And the enemy knows that, and so he will sow things in our life that will try to bring fear to us as individuals. And so whatever you're walking through today, know this, that if you will focus on God and focus on the harvest, the enemy cannot win. He cannot win. But when we start making reactionary moves, we feed into his plan. So this morning, in closing, this is what we're going to do. And if you would like to come into the altar, please remember your spacing. And I know you're wearing a mask now, but if you'd like to come to the altar this morning, I'm going to, in a moment, open our altars for anybody that would like to come. But if you want to pray where you are, you feel free to do so. But whatever that thing is that's got your attention, that negative thing that has your attention, today I'm praying that we would make the shift in our mind to take our eyes off the negativity and focus it on the positivity of what God is doing. Focus it on the positivity of what God is doing. Because God is doing something in your life right now. We all have testimonies of what God is doing in our life right now. And so today, in closing, we're going to focus on the good. Oh, my foot hurts me, but I'm still standing. I'm going to focus on the good. I'm still here. Check engine light came on in the car today on the way to church. But I still could drive it. I'm still here. What is it that God is doing in your life? Let's champion that thing today. In closing, let's champion that thing today. Man, God, I am so thankful today for your word. Because God, at times in life when I can get overwhelmed by all the enemy's stuff that he tries to bring into my life, all those ways he tries to sneak stuff in, and he tries to plant stuff into my mind, he tries to plant stuff into my spirit, God, that would steal my faith from you, that would have me walk in fear rather than in faith, that would have me fear the future rather than walk with boldness towards it. Ha. God, when he tries to do those things, God, help me see
the blessings of the Almighty. Help me see the harvest that is growing in my life, that you have allowed to grow in my life, that you have brought in for me to take in as mine. Help us become aware of the enemy's motives and his moves so that we know, hey, God, this thing that seems like a blessing is really a trap that's going to bury me if I step into it. Give us wisdom and discernment to know which decisions are the right decisions to make and which decisions are the wrong decisions to make. For you are the God of the harvest. This is your harvest. We are your people. This is your church. And God, we are here to serve you, to bless you, to honor you, to work in your kingdom. And it is an honor today that we can stand here with the blood of Christ applied to our life, with the name of Jesus applied to our life, with the spirit of creation dwelling within inside of us. That is such a miracle. But so many times we can lose focus of those miracles because of the enemy's negative around us. Shataya siya lalando sato. Siya doya shataya siya taya siya doya shataya siya lalando shataya sando. Sitaya shando ya sato. Yalalalando shato. God, break down, Lord, I pray, the walls of our mind. Shialalando sato ya sata. God, let us see the goodness of God. Free us, God, I pray. Bring us up out of Egypt. Bring us up out of negative situations. God, lift us up, I pray, by your word. Lift us up, I pray, by your spirit. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, God, free us in this place, I pray. God, let our spirits be free, I pray, in your presence this morning. God, we give you all the praise and the glory. We give you all the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name. If you want to pray where you are, if you'd like to come to the altar is open. But I want to encourage us today. Let's plug in. Let's plug in to what God is wanting to do. Let's let God break down the walls and break down the barriers in our mind, and that our spirits would be free to move in Him. Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.
I know the Master of the rain. I know the maker of the rain. He can calm the storm and make the sun shine again. I know the Master of the wind. I know the Master of the wind. I know the Master of the wind.
I know how this story ends.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Let's thank him for that word today. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen, amen. God is good. Amen. Ha! I'm leaving with some victory in my spirit today for what God has done and what God is doing. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just a reminder to everybody, Tuesday morning prayer, Wednesday morning Bible study this week. Wednesday, the podcast comes out, and Friday night youth. Things are getting back on track. Over the next couple weeks, I would say to us as a church, just be prepared for some shifting. We have a lot of work before we leave here and go there. Sound equipment and the music and everything has to be shifted. That's going to take some time. So as we come to church over the next couple of weeks, just be prepared to flex a little bit. We may not have all of our sound. We may not have all everything we need. So, that's going to be exciting. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Wow. Look at this good group of young people. Woohoo! Awesome. You know what? We're going to pray for these young people this morning before we leave. This is a very unprecedented time for us, but it is also a very unprecedented time for our kids. And going back to school and all the things that challenges that we're facing. They need our prayer. Amen. Amen. So let's pray for these young people, but pray for our young adults going into university, starting university again. Sister Kristen's back with us from Jamaica. She's back for school. It's great to see her and have her back here and at Calvary. But we need to pray for our those of our students that are students in our church. God, we come to you today on behalf of our children, on behalf of our young people, on behalf of our young adults, and God, even our adults that are going back into education, going back to school, Lord. God, this is such a weird time and things are so upside down, but God, we know you are in control. We know you are in control. And God, these young people are in your hands. God, we place them in your hands today. We plead the blood of Christ over them, Lord. Over their minds, God, I pray that the enemy would not be able to infiltrate into their thoughts and plant seeds of negativity and seeds that the enemy would try to sow into their lives, God. We come against those things in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, Jesus. God, today we come against things that would try to harm them physically, Lord. God, the sicknesses that may try to attach themselves to them. God, we bind those sicknesses today in the name of Jesus Christ. God, we bind the things that would try to pull these young people away from you, that would try to destroy their lives, God. We come against those things by the authority of the Word of God and by the authority of the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, today I pray that, God, our students would walk with angels around about them. That, God, when they walk down the corridors of their school, God, when they sit in the classrooms and the teachers are teaching, God, I pray around about them in the realm of the Spirit, there would be warring angels that would stand. There would be angels of protection that would stand. There would be angels, Lord, of provision that would stand. God, Lord, bless these young people, I pray, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. God, we give this to you today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. God, we put a hedge of protection up around our youth, around our young adults. We plead the blood of Christ over them today. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Shut tight. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Sia la la la
Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. You are dismissed this morning. Whenever you feel free to go, you're free to go. And if you want to stand and stay in prayer for a little bit longer, feel free to do so as well. God bless you and have a great week.